getting those messages across on the ground. And that's very good, it's very delicate, because of the bonus. And we have to bear that in mind. And what we do now, really well, because what we delivered and what we started to deliver with the walking centres, you know, 10 years ago, has evolved. And so we always have to bear that in mind, healthcare evolves.
So, Councillor Carrigan, what we've heard a lot during this consultation, we've done many consultation events alongside people from our deaf community, British Sign Language Interpreters helped in all this. We've done some special sessions with members of the Irish community as well, Mike.
Yeah.
And also people representing people with learning disabilities and learning difficulties. I know that these people are already marginalised within society, they're difficulty accessing public services and services generally. And therefore we need to create a service offering that makes it easy for them. We've heard that very, very clear from them. And we will actually take that into account as we consider the outcomes of this consultation and how we'll take that going forward. So I think your point was about that. It was about not just digitalisation,
leaving people behind, but actually also the fact that even public communication is a complex way of using people still do it. What's the difference between public communication now and I was saying go to UBCC and you do these, how's that going to be any different than the problems we've had in trying to stop people going to Amy currently? My concern here. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you. I'm going to bring Ben in, you've just been very patiently waiting there, and then I'm going to go across to Phil. Thank you, Ben.
Thank you. I've got a couple of questions about the case for change paper and some of the statements made in it, which quite important. One, page 19, there's a statement that nationally there's been a 26% increase in A&E attendance over the last 10 years, and new forms of urgent care services, such as walk-in centres, urgent care centres, have failed to reduce A&E attendances. There's a bizarre statement because you're planning on building an urgent care centre to reduce A&E attendances as part of this. But also, I looked at the reference for that, which was King's Fund document from 2015, and that in turn based the reference to walk-in centres on 2011 Department for Health data, which said that the growth of new forms of urgent care, such as walk-in and urgent care centres, have failed to reduce A&E attendances, which grew by 30% between 2003-04 and 2011-12. So basically this statement is backed up by something from 2011. My concern is that you're saying that walk-in centres have failed to reduce A&E attendances, but since 2010, 40% of the walk-in centres in the country have closed, and actually A&E attendances have increased even faster since that stage. So I have trouble with that statement.
And when you read it like that, I can certainly see why you think, well, where are you doing this?
Why
are you
doing
urgent treatment
centres? So
the, what we're doing is putting an urgent treatment, what our proposal is for an urgent treatment centre on the hour clock slot so that patients are directed to the urgent treatment centre and only get into the emergency department, because we have to start calling the emergency department. Difficult, as we said earlier, it can be confusing for people. The access to the emergency department is via an ambulance or if the patient deteriorates in the urgent treatment centre, and by that way it offers a front door approach, so patients are seen in the urgent treatment centre and only get to the emergency department if their clinical need warrants that. So what has happened previously with the development of walk-in centres and with the development of other urgent care centres around the country is that they have increased the demand because you're offering additional services. What this is doing is putting a filter mechanism in to ensure that only the most clinically appropriate patients will be seen at the emergency room. So in order to facilitate reducing that 20% increase, in fact bringing that down considerably.
You could just allow the point I was making, or maybe I've asked like I have Brian to do, but my big concern is that the paper says walk-in centres, urgent care centres have failed to reduce A&E attendances, but I don't think that's true. And I don't think the evidence that you cited supports that statement.
So draw your attention to page 20. That actually what we have seen in Wirral is a 5.43% reduction in walk-in attendances from April to March 2017. We have continued to see, albeit a marginal increase in A&E attendance, but the real issue is A&E admissions. So we are admitting more people, but because as elsewhere in the data suggests, we have more frailty coming through. And that frailty is not being dealt with in a manner that is timely and efficient, because there's also a proportion of people in those walk-in centres, in those A&Es, who could be seen in a different place. So we are seeing a diversion, albeit marginal, people from using walk-in centres to using A&E level 3. Perhaps not the same level as the national data suggests, but we are seeing that utilisation. And we are also among some of the worst performing in the country and have been for some time.
I've got one other point from the evidence. Page 20, an evidence review carried out by Sheffield University in 2014 found that attempts to make access easier via services such as water centres and NHS Direct and NHS 111 increased expectations and consequently increased demand. Firstly, I think when we talk about demand, we should, I always find it interesting to hear that, because you're not creating more ill people. It's about where those people present and what stage they present. And part of my concern is that encouraging people to present and increasing expectations could have a beneficial effect if it means people presenting earlier and not when they're more ill and more difficult to treat. So I just wondered if you comment.
So part of this is about clinical appropriateness and why, as part of this, when we move on, we need to encourage use of such things as pharmacies and self-care and so forth. So somebody said to me that they felt they, this is a GP, obviously I'm not going to say who, felt that they were giving a fabulous patient experience because somebody who had a sore throat for 20 minutes got to see a GP. Now, I didn't agree with them because I thought in normal circumstances, normal sore throat, it'd be lovely within 20 minutes you could reach the paracetamol in your open cupboard or go to your nearest pharmacy if you don't have it. So absolutely the word demand is another one that is difficult, isn't it? It's urgent care is when a person has a problem that they feel needs attention within 24 hours. That's the definition. But it's a matter of what the issue is. I'm trying to assist, and the majority of people are not clinically qualified, are they? It's how to assist the people to get appropriate care for the care that they need, if you know what I mean. It's how to get the most appropriate, so that the resources we have are used in the best way.
Just one more quick point on that bit of evidence. The paper that is quoted as being definitive from Sheffield in 2014 actually didn't reach a conclusion. And it said, for example, that lack of national data on urgent care, contacts with primary care, make it difficult to assess whole system demand. And there's various other caveats it gave to its findings, but it was relatively near to quite firm finding. But what I did notice that that Sheffield paper cited an emergency medical journal survey from which found that the opening of a walk-in centre created a significant reduction in GP time, daytime attendances at the adult emergency department. So it's been presented more here, but when I actually followed it, it seemed to present the outcome which supports the fact that walk-in centres reduce any attendances.
So there is a positive national data around actual usage of GPs. More reliable data is acute hospital-based, hospital-level social assistance and so on. But we do know, and most of the evidence points to the fact, that about 90% of urgent care actually happens in GP surgeries and is dealt with by GPs. The box below and the summary of national evidence also, for me, points to why this is a particular issue for Wirral, because we have the double whammy of deprivation being a significant factor from the east of the borough, and a largely elderly population in the west of the borough, particularly around West Kirby and those areas. So we have a number of the factors that contribute to increased demand for walking. wasn't afraid they found it. Can you just remind me, please, if I say it? There was something else you said. It would do because walking centres will be counted in the data like three activity, whereas when they presented an A&E, they would be presented as any activity. That was the point you were after.
It was.
Sorry, I lost my way.
That's all right. You have to go
for
one time.
Well,
Paul, will you
round
up the
questions
and
answers
then?
Thank you very much, Chair. I've just arranged my poor colleague to give the officers in Cheshire his name I didn't catch, for which I apologise.
I'm Laura Marsh, Director of Police.
Thank you very much, welcome. I also welcome all the people from Cheshire here. I'm not quite sure how the consultation cut off date fits in Cheshire's programme for the issues. Conscious that maybe to extend it so Cheshire members can go away and reflect on what they've heard tonight. I produced this little pack, which I managed to send by email yesterday to the Cheshire members. I courteously, I hope, sent it to Banks and Jackie. I handed out some copies this evening, and the world members have it. I started to look at this issue, I go back 8-10 years when Councillor Mitchell and I were concerned about difficulties in getting through on the phone, and we got a centre established in Eastern after much debate and discussion in the area. The first page lists some of the distances in the box. So we've got the distance from Cllr Chester Hospital to Eastern is 8.4 miles. So in my mind, I then looked at various locations in the Little Sutton, Great Sutton area where there are estates, and you'll see the estates I've listed. Very conscious that our guests from Cheshire are from, I think Margaret represents rural areas, Ben is from Wakeham. I'm sorry, I think you're in the council then?
No, I represent all
of them. So I want to provide some local knowledge and hope that you'll be in touch with the members in your locality itself.
I grew up at Wendy, sir.
Sorry?
I grew up at Wetherby Way, so...
Wetherby Way is a nice collection of winky houses from the 70s, yeah. Can I ask you to turn to page 2? Illustration 1 is the second page, so it's the map. If I were looking at it, I'm grateful for Ben's advice. I would look at deprived areas. Essentially, Rossmore Road East is on the map, between there and the town centre. Because they're looking at all the estates built in 1900, 1910, Prince's Road and all that area. Another deprived area, I think, will perhaps the Stanley Grange estate, as they used to call it, and the area behind Little Sutton, and between Sutton Way and Little Sutton. Very much how social housing was in the 1950s, 60s, 70s, on the down Sutton Way. So when I got the plotting, this is simply from me, I say it may not be reliable. Therefore, I can't be sure that these are actually all medical practices. So I'll leave that and turn to illustration 2, if I may, which is pitched from the Cheshire website. The general practice is coming out. So I didn't put the whole table in. I left out the far side of Cheshire. I could see that Neston, which we talked about earlier, as the surgery in Mellon Lane. Since I was fostered in Neston for some years, I know where Mellon Lane is, so I'm all right there. I can see Elsie Paul, there's why you be the hospital, which is near Whitby, and I can see the requirement to go to Chester. I declared an interest area earlier, because CWP operates the urgent treatment centre, and I'm going to CWP. I've not been involved in discussions about it, so I think I'm free to look at the issue. I take note of what our Cheshire Building Office has said about, well, we've got a system in place. I think there's the not misunderstanding it. So you forgive me if I then try to flick a little bit to my illustration 5. This did appear in the pack that was given you tonight on page 5. And this is the West Cheshire Walking Centre activity. As an Eastern member, the southern end of the borough anyway, and as a patient of Dr. Cowan's practice, then I've been looking over the board to see what there is. Now, I heard that you were explaining what people like to do. So this diagram I've labelled 5, I first saw when I went to the Osipor consultative meeting. And Jackie very kindly provided it to me. So looking at the surgeries on there, if we look particularly at the Great Southern Medical Centre, in the box towards the bottom, you've got practice area, East Amara Park, VCH, Grand Total and so on. So if we look particularly at the Great Southern Medical Centre, the Whitby Group Practice, the Hope Farm Medical Centre and York Road, then those seem to be, even in the arrangements we have, quite big users of Eastern. Now, I don't have a detailed analysis of why they went to Eastern. It comes back to my colleague's point about when you want something, feel you need something, want to access something, then you look for the most convenient place. Which really brings me back to distances. Somewhere in the middle of Elsinore, possibly Sudbury for all I know, at some point, people take a decision, am I going to go south to the Countess, or am I going to go north? And if I go north, I can go up the A47, or I can nip up the M53 for another quarter of an hour, 20 minutes, and get to Cllr Park, or I can break off the M53 and A41 and go to Eastern, which is, I think, a significant point. So I'm interested in this issue, which is emerging, by a joint commission to look at what the needs are in the area. Could I invite you to look at, I'm trying to not take too much time, page 7 of the document I've put together. I submitted, first of all, there's a history to Eastern, which our Cheshire colleagues but Eastern we do. Mr. Banks and my colleague had a little debate about that earlier. They say that in 18 months ago we were confronted with a situation where we were told it was really important that our nurses from Eastern went to Arapar to help out, and we were given very short notice about that. We were not very happy about the institution, as you well know. And we grinned and bear it for a number of months, and new staff had to be trained, and Mr. Banks had to pay for it, or the cost had to be absorbed somewhere in the system. It was so. I have on a table FOI request covering July 2018. I split the table up to give you a large enough print. And I want to look at January to April and then look from May to July. Now, if you look at use of West Cheshire CCG, once we get past the extra hours that were once provided to us when the centre fully reopened, the numbers of people from West Cheshire start rising again. So very low figures in January, because they were the limited hours, as I call them. But once Eastern started to become known that it was open again, the West Cheshire use climbs. Now, I've not got figures past July. I just put an FOI request in to the Community Trust, and no doubt I'll get to reply in due course. But we've been looking at what's happened in our particular community. If I turn to page 8 of my document, this was an FOI request covering December 16 to July 17. And in that, you will see that consistently, right through from December to July, there were 200 to 300 people, vary, but you know, like the figure across 8 months of 2073. So that suggests a consistent pattern. Now, I'll come to my questions on my front page, which is the front speech, as it were. Things that we're looking at. I haven't studied the OBR arrangements in Cheshire, so I hold my hands up, because I'm not able to go to all the practice and see what the extended hours are. The key thing for anyone in the southern end of Wales is what we have on offer here equal to or better than what's in place now? Points have been made about clinical need and points have been made about communication. So I'm well aware we all have Choose Well campaigns, a whole range of various slogans over recent years.
try to change the way people feel like services. The book of it comes down to us, Reese, and the issue of where the four localities are going to be, and how they can. I just want to bring in notes by looking at page 4 of my document, the South Wirral locality, which is a slide that has been provided to us by Jack East, so I'm grateful for the openness on this issue. So, page 4 in mine and page 7, the ones you were given in the sheets tonight. But on my page 4, I have nicked from the table provided to us the present activity plan for the extended hours. And you will see that the sites in East Stilson, like T. Egg Lane, that's what the original plan for the number of additional appointments was. And we're told that it's now changing and increasing.